I'm on now. Yeah, okay, thank you. Well, welcome for the second presentation. I'm going to talk about how to create RESTful API. REST is not something new. It's been here for like 12 years since Mr. Roy Fielding wrote a dissertation about it. So if you actually want to learn something new, you should go to the other room. It's PHP 5.4. That's really new. So. My name is Mark Iepes. I'm from the Netherlands. I'm known as on Twitter and IRC as Kiram. I don't know how you would pronounce it in English. Been working 4 years with CakePHP. And I'm undercover as programmer because it's not really my profession. For me, it's just a hobby, and I've been on the core CakePHP team for about 1.5 years. So that's a little bit about me. What I'm going to talk about, rest my case, that's just basically introduction to what is REST, and then how to REST your cake, how to apply those things, routings and other things. We're going to describe the constraints that are part of REST. It's basically a set of constraints that define an architectural structure. It's not really a protocol like it is, like SOAP is, or that's what it really means: representational state transfer. Architectural style is focused on resource. You manipulate the representation, so you send it up a full state representation up and down. That's what it's based on, and well, mostly used with HTTP, but it does not have to be HTTP only. You can use FTP in RESTful style, basically. It does same thing, put something on a resource with an identifier. I'll get to that in a bit. I'm not going forward. Oh. Yeah, I'm. These are the constraints that define the style, the architectural style. Client-server separation. So the client does not really know it's talking to the server or another component in between. They're completely decoupled. Has to be stateless. So the server does not keep sessions server side. It does not know about the application session. You can have sessions, but that is all application side. The server does not know about anything. Uniform interface, that is one of the most important and also most discussed things, I think, about REST, how to do it right. Cache is a very important part of REST. And a layered system, basically it means you have several components. You have the client, you have the caches, reverse proxy, the server, and they all are independent of each other. They don't know about the other layers in the system. They have to work independently. Well, the separation also improves portability of the across systems, so you can plug in other components in between the layers and without any issues. Let's see what I have here in my notes. Well, that's all then that. I'll go first into the uniform uniform interface. What does it mean, the uniform interface? You have a resource. Identification of the resource, the manipulation through the representation, it means you transferring a representation of the resource and you manipulate it on the server side or on the client side, and that's sent up and forth. It's basically that's what very important in REST is. The messages being sent between the client and server are completely self-descriptive. We'll get into this all later on. Both the request and the response messages are self-descriptive, content type, cache controls, linking. That is the last part, hypermedia as the engine of application state with a new term, HATEOAS. That's also called level 3 of REST, so by someone describing it as the highest level of REST by the true Restafarians. I'm not gonna tell you what is the best way, or because like Mark said it last night, it was a good topic for a nerd fight, because someone will always tell you you're doing it wrong, and maybe they're even right. And I'll just go into how I interpreted it and what you think you can do or should do, or not should do. I'm not telling you what you should do. I think I'll tell what I think I would do. But my opinion on it changes every day, because then I look back at it from a different perspective and I think, if you do it like this, it's still within the REST constraints. It's just a matter of opinion, I think. This is the response. I actually stole this from Mr. Fielding's publication itself, with a little adaptation from the I don't know the word for it in English, I'm sorry. I'm not a native English speaker, so. It is a little bit changed because it was changed afterwards and they don't change the RFCs and the original context that was added later on. What do we have here? I'm still 7 here, okay. We have the resource, which can be a user, a book, or whatever. The identifier for it, usually we use a integer ID or a UUID. Some people even use just a name, which is unique. Doesn't really matter, there's something that uniquely identifies that specific resource. The representation of it, of the resource, which is a data component, which can be text, HTML, XML, YAML, even JSON. I think JSON and XML is mostly used, but it doesn't restrict it to a single type. You shouldn't even restrict it to a single type. You should offer several content types. There's content negotiation, the client just says, I accept this and this and this format, and you should try to be able to send it back in the requested format, content type. That's in the metadata of the representation. You have the content type or the last modified time, or all that is part of the representation of the resource. You have resource metadata, so you have that uses links, which are a part of the hypermedia, hypertext. And you have control data like cache control, validation, that kind of things. That's all in the message that's being sent back and forth. This is what basically defines the messages. I have to press this one as well. Well, this is what we know, the remote procedure calls, the RPC style of interface. You see all kind of links like this, get user profile with an ID. This is not what they call REST. It is an API, it will serve JSON or XML. But as you can see, there's not a resource here. There is a resource within it. The resource would be a user profile. So it's close. That is all different kinds of, I just made them up. The problem with this is you have to document all these functions or URLs or what's possible with your API. It's you don't know upfront what you can do. You have to document it for the developers so they can know what they can do with your API. So it's a steep learning curve because they have to read a lot of documentation and it differs for every API. And if you use REST as your style for the API, if people know REST, how that works, they should be able to work with any API that is RESTful, because they all work the same because of the uniform interface. REST uses only two base URLs. You have the users, the resource, and you have the resource with the identifier. And you can get the user's collection, or you can add one user to the collection, and you can get or add or delete a single resource within the collection. As you can see here, I have put method. This HTTP method is used as the kind of the procedure, the operation that is being performed on the resource. So instead of you have the function in the URL and just get it or post it with a single method, always using get or always using post, like SOAP does. Mostly it's all post, post, post. Even if you're trying to get information, you're posting. REST uses put and delete methods as well. Not every server accepts it by default. You can configure it so it will. You can use the override method header. But put and delete, well, put is not really update, because it's what we know update with the edit form. You can change a few fields and then push it to the server, or post it or put it to the server. But a put in REST would mean replace a complete resource, because you get the resource, you manipulate it and push it in a complete resource representation back. So update is not really update as we know it. It's a complete replacement of the document. What you'll notice, the nouns and the verbs is very important in the REST style. You have a noun in the URL and you have the verb in the HTTP method, unlike the RPC style, where you have both sometimes in the URL only, and use a single method for all. Well, this is a typical request. It's nothing special about it, but you can see you're making use of all the parts in the message. You have the resource, the identifier, the HTTP method. You have the content type negotiation. You could add if modified since. If you have got the resource before, you got a modified header, so you can use it and check if you already, if it has changed. So all you need to know is already in the message. You can get a response for that, like a 200 OK. Does anybody know the number I've put? Mariano, do you recognize it? Books with number? No? Doesn't ring a bell? Okay, you should check it out. It's a good book, I think. It's the ISBN number I used for Mariano's book on CakePHP 1.3. It didn't. And the host is Amazon, not Amazon, but changed a little bit. this could be a request for, response for it. You have the response code, 200 OK. You have some metadata for it. I have nothing on this. No. Last modified content link, content type, and then you have the message itself, the body. So all is in there. And then if it's not modified, we'll just get a response without a body. Well, it uses the several HTTP methods, get, put, delete, post. There's also a new method, patch. I'm not really sure if it's accepted. Anybody know? It's proposed standard, it's published. Yeah, it's really accepted. I think so too, because Ruby on Rails 4.0 is on beta like for half a year now, I think. And they will replace the put method by patch in their core to do the updates. You have save methods. It's basically get, because nothing will change on the server side. You just get information. So unlike a lot of RPC APIs, you can get something and something changes on the server. Well, that's not safe. So you should not really use get to perform some process on the server, like manipulate data of the resource. You have put and delete are idempotent. You hear about that. Basically, it just means if you would perform the same request again, it would not have side effects. So if you update something on the server, so you or maybe delete is a simpler example. You delete user 1234. If you would perform the same request again, there would not be any side effect. So it doesn't delete something again, or if you replace it, it doesn't update it again. So unlike post, if you do post again, like adding a resource, if you would resend the request, it would add the same resource again. So it means there is some side effect on the server. Yeah. Well, this is this discussion. You can go both ways. What is true REST? Should I use sub-resources? You have books and then the identifier, and then you want to get the votes for the book. Well, it probably has a lot of votes for it because it's a very good book. But should I get it now at resource identifier and then sub-resource, or should it be a separate resource with a get query parameter? Well, there's several ways to go about it. I started to go for the bottom one, but nowadays I think top one is okay as well, and you can, yeah, you can go two ways. Even kijken. Did it go? Here you have as well, can I post to the sub-resource? Or should I just put, and the data will contain the sub-resource data? I think both is would be good to use. It's a matter of preference, whatever you like best. Well, this is the patch method I just spoke about. It's Rails, Ruby on Rails will use it as the new primary method for updates, and there's a URL is on the bottom where you can find more about it and why they think they should use it. And problem with patches at the moment, there is not really much information about how it should be used. There's no description of it, how to use the patch, but I think it's pretty well, the best method to just update a single field of a resource. There's also the level 3 of REST maturity model. That's the hypermedia as the engine of the application state. That's what most REST APIs don't get to or don't want to get to. It's just how strict you want to be following the rules. Level 0 would be a single URI, so you have a single endpoint with all kind of methods. URLs, like I just showed on the RPC URL styles, and you use get or post for everything. SOAP uses that. For instance, it has a single endpoint and you post everything to that single URL. Then you can go to use several URLs, but still use the same method, post or get. That's one behind. So that's level 1, and most people go to level 2 easy. That's using the resource with the identifier and the several post methods. That's basically what most people consider being good REST. And well, I think it's pretty good. And from there, it's just a matter of interpretation on how to use the hypermedia as the engine of the application state. I think it would be pretty nice if you can go to level 3, especially on the caching part. Level 3, because the responses, the representations, are completely self-descriptive. You can negotiate the media type, you can use links, which is a very important part of the hypermedia. And you can even switch to other protocols, so you can even switch within the response, let's say IRC protocol, to open something on the client side on our protocol. You can all contain that within the message. You can get comments for the book with a number. The request can include a link to the book resource ID. So the comments won't include the book data, just a link to it. And in fact, what we currently do when you go to an index URL, or it would be a comments index URL with filtered on the book ID, we now often return a whole array of all comments. But if you go to level 3 of REST, if we keep with the levels, it would only include links to all those comments. So you can even paginate it. So I would not advise to order descending, just ascending. So page 1 will stay page 1 forever, so it can stay in cache. It has the links to the first 10 comments, so it can stay in cache. The more layers of cache, the better it is. Browsers have caches, but your client API, the client that is coded against the API, can have its own cache. It can be a mobile application, can be another website application. They can have their own cache for your responses, but there can also be several layers in between, like Varnish, or like Jose just showed, you can have a dispatcher filter on your application that already filters it with a HTTP response cache. So you can do it on your server side, have some extra caching. It's a very important part of REST, because you're all breaking it into small pieces with links to each other, and all those small pieces are better cacheable than having one response that has all the information, and if there's just one comment added, the whole response cache has to be wiped out because just one comment was added. So just use links to all those small pieces of information. Oh, that doesn't really. I'm using here a relative URL, but I would advise to use absolute URLs in your links, so the client doesn't have to know how to build the links to the other resources. Your server should provide it. It's also easy if you would change something. Let's say you want to have the books on this host and you would want to have the comments on a subdomain. What wouldn't make sense for books and comments, but if you want to link to something else and you want to put it somewhere else, the client should not be aware of how to build the URLs. So you should really provide absolute URLs, including the domain. Yeah, well, this is comment one. The comment is great book, and it only has a link where I can get the book information itself. It will be in XML style, and this is what it would look like in JSON. This is described somewhere in some JSON formatting, how to format links. It would be links, href, should be a full URL as well. So you don't include the data. So if you have a book with comments or comment related to a book, just only that piece of information and a link to the associated. You can also use links in your headers. I took this from GitHub. They actually use this for pagination, and it's perfectly fine to put that in the link headers, so the client can use those to go to the next page or the last page. So this is a very important part of the hypermedia as the engine of the application, using links within your representations. Another very important part is make use of the status codes. There's humans read the messages, but this is code reading your response, and that will handle codes better than messages. Status codes are defined in RFC, so we all know what it means. 200 is okay, and 404 does not exist. Well, there's 40, 50, I don't know how many there is exactly, but basically you will be fine with using just between 5, 10 maybe. Well, here's some commonly used within a REST API. There is Facebook, I don't know if they're still doing it, but they're showing 200 okay for everything. If it's the message is okay, but even if there's an error, they give a 200 okay, and the content of the response will be error with a message. Humans can read it, but the computer thinks it's okay, so you should not really use the 200 okay for every request. Make use of the status codes. It is uniform interface. It's all described, so your API client code can understand that. You can even use the links to link to a support page. Would be perfectly fine to describe it there. So your response will be 405. It's a not allowed method. The response will include the allowed methods. But if you want to provide extra information, you can use links, and you can even decide if it's JSON or XML, it's for the developer, or is it HTML, you can show it to the end user of the API client. And another very important part, which we covered already a little bit, this should be cacheable using the HTTP cache headers. So it's just not about caching on the server side your SQL queries or views. Use the cache headers so you can add the extra components in between the proxy caches, reverse proxies, browser caches, or the client API caching. There are several cache headers, cache control, private, public, maxh, smaxh, it's a shared proxy, shared cache, maxh, must revalidate. It means you can use the same cache item, but you must check first if it's really not modified. If it is modified, you cannot use it. If it's modified, you are allowed to reuse it. So even if you set a max age for like 1 week, I still want you to revalidate within the 1 week if it's still valid. Or no cache, some things you don't want to cache. You can tell that all in the cache headers. You have cache validation as well. You can in your response, you can send an e-tag. When you get a resource, you can get, make an e-tag for it, which will identify that specific response. Last modified time, that will be sent in the response. And if the client will then request again, it will ask if it's modified since the date. If it has, I would like to get some fresh information. If it's not, just tell me with a 3 or 4, it's not modified. That's using the date. If non-matched, that's using the e-tag. It's just some hash that's generated by the server, which is unique for that single resource. That's used for a get method. You would use if match if you would do a put on the same resource because you want to change it, update, you want to send a changed representation of that resource, but it should only perform the update if the e-tag matches, so you don't know, so you know that's not conflicting with the with the resource on the server side, which might have been changed by some other user in between. So you compare the e-tag if it's still valid to perform the update, so you don't overwrite the other changes that have been made in between. Well, this is an introduction into what REST means. Might not be what you're looking for, because you might be want to do some translations, calculations. Sometimes just doesn't fit REST. Also, you can think about if what level you can go to. You can claim that your API is RESTful. Yeah, be careful with it, calling it true REST, because there's, well, it probably isn't. It's, I think there's only one guy in the whole world that knows really what true REST is, and that's the guy that wrote the dissertation 12 years ago. Is there any questions so far? It's a bit about the REST style. No? Did I really explain it, or you already knew it already?
How do you handle like actions that aren't like get, put, and post? Or how would you, how could you handle, like, if I'm gonna send something by post, or send something by, like, you know, send a package to someone, like a physical package, how would I do that through a REST service?
Can you post it as part of the body content of the request?
Okay.
Or a regular post?
It's some sort of like magic action thing that goes in there?
If I wanted to post some data into one of the URLs.
Yeah, say I want to send a book to you.
Yeah.
And I have the books resource.
Yeah.
Should I take that resource and like appended as a put to some other fake resource?
Yeah, well, post is used often for such operations. You could create a resource that you are creating a new order or something, or you order it and you want to send it to him, or I'm not completely sure what you mean, how you would send it, but you can have a resource for it, for that kind of operations, and just post it to that, because you create a new order, and you can have a link with a book number. Yeah, there's several ways to go around it, and well, sometimes you really need, like you asked now, for you want to trigger some procedure on the other end. So some implementations just don't have true REST implementation, and well, a true REST API should not have documentation itself. It should have one link, just your domain and dash API. And then everybody should know from there. You can return a list of resources that are available on the base URL, and from there you can just traverse through all the links and get the books, get the users, and from there you can go to the resource ID, and they're all linked together with the hypermedia links. So basically, you shouldn't have any documentation for the API itself, because it's the REST constraints define how your API works, in contrary to the remote procedures. You have to describe what your API can do, while on REST you only have to describe what your resources are available, but you can do that on the endpoint. I will show it. With Cake, how you can do that, just show all the resources. Well, I'm not sure if it's in there. So if you would like to have some procedure call within your REST API, yeah, you would have to document it somewhere. And well, I think it's fine. And I'm not saying there should be a true REST API. So any more questions?
Mm-hmm. I personally prefer just to stick with JSON, but I don't know, from a consumer perspective, it makes sense to add more than one type of message.
Yeah, well, some people say it's not true REST if you only serve JSON. I think it's perfectly fine to serve one format. You have content negotiation, and if someone requests XML and you don't have it, you just respond. Oh, the computer goes to sleep. You just respond with an error message and explain that's the wrong format, and I think it's okay. But it would be better to serve in multiple formats, so it's more clients can use it, because you don't know what the other side wants to use. It's the application that's programmed against your the information you are servicing. So it would be better to serve it in several formats. So the client can choose. Yeah, but using YAML files as well nowadays, YAML response for REST APIs. I think that's quite useful as well. But you can even serve HTML, just plain HTML. It's just the client application. They only have to know how to parse the data, and if they request HTML and you can serve HTML and they can parse it, it's even RESTful. There's nothing wrong with that again as well. Just yeah, the data and the links would be enough for the and the format doesn't really matter. The content type XML, JSON, just what they request. If you can send it back, you can. If your server handles it, try to serve as many content types as well as possible. But you, yeah, it's up to you if you decide to do it or not. Okay, REST my cake. We have some basic setup, which we should apply as to any web service in Cake, using JSON or XML responses, which are built in Fuse, which Mark has added. I'm very happy with it. Thank you. The first step, you would have to, oh, this one went to sleep as well. I'm sorry for that. First step would be to have your application accept JSON URL extension. You go to the right, is it readable in the back? I had to make them a little bit smaller, the font size. The config routes file, you should enable parse extension. The first one would allow all. Well, I had a discussion with Mark about it. It's a little bit magic, allow all, because it's not really allowing all. And well, you should use the bottom one, parse extension JSON or JSON XML. You can put in any type you like to serve. That's the initial step. The second step would be adding request handler component, to your components array. That would automatically switch to the correct view if you have a JSON extension in the URL or in the request header or XML. It will change to the correct view and serialize for you, or use the correct view template. So that's the second step. You can do it on the app controller, or you can do it on the controllers that only need it. That's up to you. We have the 1.3 way, which is not exactly the same as 1.3 was like. You create a JSON view template and just echo JSON encode cats, for instance, on the, and you can change here if you need it. This is how we did it in 1.3. 1.3 also used the layout. That's been taken out. You only need to define the view template itself, because the layout would be just echo content. Oh yeah, one other thing the request handler will do, if you would, for instance, do a RSS or Atom or whatever, load the RSS helper automatically, if you would need it. It's not for the rest, but just for the request handler acting on the URL extension. Now, what is the big change here is the Cake PHP 2 way. I think it was described in the workshops, and there was something this morning about it. Serialization is being handled now completely in the JSON XML views, and to get that automatically, having done without using the view templates, you add the one in the bottom, the serialized with a underscore in front, and you set the cat view var, and you would set which view vars you want to serialize. And it will automatically JSON encode or XML build the correct response. So you would be serving in the correct format. Then I can go to the index.json URL. This is not REST, this is just basic setup. We're not really REST, because in REST I would not use the URL extension, just in the content type header. You're now just returning an array of data, a cat with a associated user. This is the first step of serving JSON with index was using the view template, and the next one is view one. That's not using the view template, it's using the serialized cat. So this is one cat with one user. So you now already have set it up to serve JSON and XML. This is the initial setup. Well, now how to make it REST routing. You have resource mapping, you have cats, and you have cats one. That should be what your URLs look like. To get that, Cake has built-in REST resource routing. You would do in your routes file map resources with cats and users. So it would build the correct URLs for your cats and users. Controller. You can have more controllers within your application, but only serve these as REST URLs. You don't have to serve all your data within your REST, of course. As you can see now, I have dropped the URL extension because it should be in the header, so I'm not using it anymore. I'm just leaving it off, but if you would request this with a content type of accept type request header, it would serve the correct format. Well, you just did a map resources. What would it do? It would. This is the basic routing it would set up for you. It's get cats, it will route to index. Post cats, it will route to add. Get cats one, it will, well, you can see them, which are there. This is how it is set up, and well, the put is edit, and your application edit would accept a partial update. So it's not really true REST, but this is the initial setup that Cake will handle for you by using map resources. Well, to be able to accept put and delete, I had to do this on my config of the Apache. The method override is handled now by... otherwise, I had to set method override in the request, and I don't have to do it now anymore. You can also define your own resource map for the map resources, so you can... top ones are core ones, and you can add more to it. So if you set it up like this, you would map put to replace. That would replace a complete resource. You can use the patch method and map it to the update. Cake does not support patch at the moment, unless Mark added it last night. No, he didn't. Well, it will be added to Cake Core, but at the moment, you have to use the add detector. I will show it later on how to do that. As you can see, ID false or ID true, and so it reads the URL, sees if there's an ID in it, and if it's a get method or a post method, and it will map it to the correct action. And it will do this for all the controller names that are in the map resources call I just showed you. If you do that, first build your resource map and then call map resources, otherwise it won't pack up the resource map. Let's see, I have three controllers, but one of them is a plugin controller. So I have cats, users, and I have pizza plugin with orders controller. It would build the URLs here on the bottom. Cats, users, and pizza orders. It's suddenly a strange URL, because now pizza looks like a resource, but it's not really a resource, it's your plugin just to separate your logic, so it should not be in the URL. There is a way so you can change it. You can set prefix API, what's going to change in Cake 3. Mark is changing the routes system completely, but in Cake 2 you can use it this way. Prefix all the URLs with API. So now you can see the pizza is gone. it will just replace it with API. You can do that because in Cake2 we're not using namespaces, so you won't have conflicting controller names, so orders can only be at one time in your application. If you use namespaces and you have two order controllers, you have to set it up differently, but it will change in Cake3 anyway. So now you have endpoints API for all your URLs. I won't use them from now on. I will drop it, but remember, all URLs now start with API, and you have cats, users, and orders as your resource collections. Oh, wrong one. You can also, you can see I'm adding this one, ID. You can restrict it to be UUID only or ID only. So drop the double W in front of ID and it will only accept integers. By default, it accepts integers and UUIDs. It does not accept string. There's two regex for it in the router class that will check if it's matching ID or UUID. Yeah, we're dropping the JSON extension. Sometimes you see format is JSON as well. I think you should not use it. I wouldn't say should. I would not use it. Well, because it's not part of the resource itself. It's more like metadata. You should just put it in the request header as accept application JSON and then the cats. There's many REST APIs use it like that, but I would advise using the accept headers. Here we have cats, but I only want to get sleeping cats. You can have custom find methods for it, or I don't know, you can handle it in several ways, but you want to have just a conditional get for the cat collections. I would use cat with status is sleeping or sleeping is one. And same thing with post recent. It just looks like a sub resource now, but it's just basically a conditional get. So you should use the query parameters for that. If you really want or must or have to use the named parse parameters, you need to set additional routing for it as well, because it does not accept it, because it only will accept the resource and the ID, and anything beyond that it won't pick up anyway. So I have to do additional router setup for it. Like you can see here, you have to do for every controller, you have to do this to be able to use the sub resource URL. The cat's sleeping and the post recent. To make it work, you have to set it up to accept everything after the resource, which is not UUID or ID. Well, there would be a non-API URL. I'm just showing top ones is would be in your application, users vote 1, 2, 3, 4. I want to vote on this user. You can do it with get, which is not following REST style, because you're performing a state change within your server. You can post using post link. In your REST, you would use API users 1, 2, 3, 4. I'm running a little late, I see. You have a users controller vote that would handle that. Well, you can route it there too, or you can. This is how to set it up. If you want to match only votes, to match it to the user's vote action. So you have the different style of route now, which would be more restful than users vote 1, 2, 3, 4. You have users 1, 2, 3, 4 votes. This is how you can set it up. Yeah, you can also create a vote resource for it and just post to that and move the logic to the vote model. And well, you can go either way, which one you prefer. This is how you would add a detector for patch method. You call cake request add detector patch and the array with the which reads the request method from the environment and value patch. There's some other things you can do. You can even map to a callback function, which would can be defined somewhere else. So you can have patch calling. So you can do cake request or this request is post. You use in your application, you can do is patch, which calls, which reads this, or you would call a callback method. I'm using it for API as well. I created a is API detector, and it would just call my callback function. And there's well all kind of checks doing it and returning true or false. These are some cake response functions you should use to make the uniform interface. You can send header values. You can also return early, just response send. You can use the status code to change it and then send. You can change the content type with these methods. And here I have listed some cache methods that would set the correct headers for the caching. Some of them are called, like check not modified is handled by request handler already, but you can call them to change them yourselves. The modified, you can set that based on the modified field in your database. If it's shareable or not, or e-tag, you can create an e-tag based on ID and some other information when it's last modified, make it unique, and change it on every update. Also has been added to the request handler, you can change class map for the view classes. So you have the built-in JSON view and you have the built-in XML view. You can override it now, setting up like that, and you can create your own JSON view and you can extend the serialize method, extend the class, base class, and create another serialize method, which would strip out the data and just put links there, for instance. Makes it more flexible. If you would, especially XML, a lot of people want to change the structure of their XML, and by default it would put response as the base element, and some people want to change it so it's more flexible. You can define your own view classes and they will be called instead for the content type. Authentication, you can have all public info, so you don't do any authentication. You can do API keys, which is not very secure, of course, but maybe just want to track who is using it and doesn't really care about securing all data, just for tracking. Basic auth, with HTTPS, of course. OAuth, I'm not going into OAuth because I've never used it myself. I should have, but. API key, how would I read it? You can create an authenticate adapter for it. I will do a talk tomorrow about extending auth component, how to create all those adapters for authentication and authorization. Yeah, well, basic auth is supported by Core. It's a Core adapter. Basically, if you create an authenticate adapter that would read a token from the header, you can send your own X API header token request. You can read it from the header, or you can read it from the query. Some people read it from the format is JSON or something. You would have an authentication adapter that would read it like this and then return the user based on the token. It's pretty simple. You set it up, just set it to use your own authentication adapter. Well, versioning. Some people say REST doesn't need versioning because it's always it doesn't change its functions. It's just your resources and your base URL would define your resource, and the client would act upon what you provide them. If you want to version it, don't go crazy on 20.0 or something. I've seen it. That would imply you're changing your versions every month. They shouldn't change that often. Just keep it simple, V1, V2, and that was it for now. I think, well, just 1 hour. Sorry?
Lunchtime.
Yeah?
Yes.
I'm done.
Yeah. No question.
Thank you.